Mr. and Mrs. Brown first met Paddington on a railway platform. In fact, that was how he came to have such an unusual name for a bear, because Paddington was the name of the station. Mr. Brown saw him first, a small, furry object sitting on an old suitcase behind a pile of mailbags near the lost property office. The bear was wearing a funny kind of hat, and on the side of the suitcase, in large white letters, were the words, "Wanted on Voyage." A label around the bear's neck said, quite simply, "Please look after this bear. Thank you." "You're a very small bear," said Mrs. Brown. The bear puffed out its chest. "I'm a very rare sort of bear," he replied. "There aren't many of us left where I come from."
"And where is that?" asked Mrs. Brown.
"Darkest Peru," said the bear importantly. And he told them all about Peru, a country far away on the other side of the world, with high mountains and deep valleys, full of strange animals and birds with unusual cries.
"When I was in Peru, I used to live with my Aunt Lucy,"
said the bear. But she had to go into a home for retired bears in Lima, so I emigrated. I came all the way by sea in a large ship. I was a stowaway. I hid in the ship's lifeboat and ate marmalade. Bears like marmalade. What are you going to do now? Asked Mrs. Brown. The bear looked around. I don't know, it said sadly. Paddington Station isn't a bit like darkest Peru. It's so crowded, and everyone seems in such a hurry. Said Mrs. Brown to her husband. I've an idea. We found him on Paddington Station. So that's what we'll call him. Paddington. Paddington, repeated the bear. Paddington. Paddington. I think I like that. It sounds very important. Good. That's settled then, said Mrs. Brown. Home you come with us, Paddington. And off they went to find a taxi. The taxi driver looked at Paddington. Bears is sixpence extra, he said gruffly. Sticky bears is ninepence. Paddington gave the man a hard stare back. Number 32 Windsor Gardens, said Mr. Brown hastily. And hurry. I expect you've had lots of adventures, said Mrs. Brown. Coming all the way from Peru. Oh, I have, said Paddington. Bears are good at having adventures, and the boat called in at lots of places on the way. In the West Indies, it was carnival time. And then in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, there was a dreadful storm. When we got to Africa, I saw a snake charmer, and in Spain, the people never stopped stamping their feet. From Peru to the Portobello Road really was quite a journey. Thank you. It took Paddington no time at all to settle down with the Browns, and he soon became one of the family. Mr. and Mrs. Brown had two children, Jonathan and Judy, and there was someone called Mrs. Bird who looked after them all. Number 32 Windsor Gardens was near the Portobello Road, and most days Paddington visited the market to get his morning supply of buns from the bakers, where he had a standing order. While he was at the market, Paddington always did the shopping for the rest of the household, and he soon became a popular figure amongst the traders.
"There's no doubt about it," said Mrs. Bird. "That bear has an eye for a bargain."
Paddington made lots of new friends, but best of all was Mr. Gruber. Mr. Gruber kept an antique shop in the Portobello Road. It was full to overflowing with old copper pots and pans, brass ornaments, books, and furniture of every shape and size. To enter it was like going into another world. There was even a musical box that played tunes. And wherever you looked, there were clocks of all shapes and sizes, ticking and chiming away. There was almost nothing that Mr. Gruber didn't have in his shop. There was almost nothing that Mr. Gruber didn't know about either. Paddington thought Mr. Gruber was the wisest person he had ever met. Most mornings they had their elevenses together. And Mr. Gruber kept Paddington on the edge of his sofa by telling him all about his early life in Hungary. "It was what was known as a café society," said Mr. Gruber. "Oh, those were the days.
people ate buns and drank cocoa far into the night. And there was music and dancing. Oh, such music. Wait, I will show you.
Mr. Gruber took a record out of a cardboard box, placed it on an old gramophone, and he showed Paddington how to do a Hungarian dance.
As the music came to an end, Paddington licked his lips and helped himself to some more cocoa. "I think I would have liked living in a cafe society, Mr. Gruber," he said. "I don't think I've ever had buns far into the night before, especially to music. They didn't have much music where I come from."
"No music?" exclaimed Mr. Gruber. "But life is nothing without music. Did they never have any concerts in the Home for Retired Bears?"
"Never," said Paddington firmly. "Bears aren't very good at music. It's a bit difficult with paws."
Mr. Gruber jumped to his feet.
"In that case, I shall take you all to a concert this very afternoon. I'll shut my shutters and close the shop, and we will all go to the Royal Albert Hall."
Paddington wasn't quite sure exactly what a concert was, but he thought the Royal Albert Hall sounded very grand indeed. And he hurried home to Windsor Gardens as fast as his legs would carry him, in order to tell the others the good news.
Yeah.
When they arrived at the Royal Albert Hall, Paddington's eyes nearly popped out of his head. "It's a very large building," he said. As they went inside and Mr. Gruber led them to their seats, Paddington saw that up on the concert platform, there was an enormous orchestra. There were so many musicians, he gave up trying to count them. "I can see why they need such a big building," he exclaimed. The trumpets were trumpeting. The flutes were fluting. The big bass drum was booming. And the violins and cellos were making a terrible din. Paddington felt very relieved when Judy explained it was only the orchestra tuning up. "I think it would be better if they tuned down," he announced in a loud voice. Judy hastily handed him a program. "That shows what they're going to play," she said. "There's a short piece to start with, then the Surprise Symphony by Haydn, followed by Schubert's Unfinished Symphony." "What?" exclaimed Paddington. "But Mr. Gruber has paid for our seats. Do you mean to say Schubert hasn't even finished his symphony?" Mr. Gruber coughed. "I don't think he ever will now, Mr. Brown. Schubert died in 1828. But Paddington wasn't listening. He was much too upset. As the conductor turned to the orchestra and the concert began, he gave the man's head some very hard stares indeed. Paddington was a bear with a strong sense of right and wrong. And as Mr. Gruber and the others closed their eyes in order to listen to the music, he rose to his feet and crept quietly away. "Excuse me," said Paddington, raising his hat to the lady behind the refreshment counter. "I'm looking for a Mr. Schubert."
"Mr. Schubert?" repeated the lady. "I don't know of anyone of that name, dear. What does he look like?"
"I don't know," said Paddington, "but he wrote a symphony and he hasn't finished it." The lady clucked sympathetically.
"That's typical of things today. Nobody finishes anything. Tell you what, why don't you go backstage and wait by the artist's entrance? You'll be bound to catch the orchestra when they come off. They'll be able to help. There's a door just along the corridor," she added helpfully. "It leads straight to the dressing rooms. You can't miss it."
Paddington thanked the lady for all her help and hurried on his way. But he found the Albert Hall was a very complicated building, and in no time at all, he was lost in a maze of corridors, one of which led to a door marked Strictly Private. The door opened easily enough, but to his horror, it closed behind him with an ominous click, and try as he might, he couldn't open it again. It was at that moment the orchestra started to play Haydn's Surprise Symphony. Paddington tried shouting for help. "Help! Help!" But nobody could possibly hear him. For all the good it did, he might just as well have saved his breath. It was Judy who noticed the knocking first. It was in the middle of the Surprise Symphony.
Bang, bang, bang!
The conductor lowered his arms and tried again.
Bang, bang, bang!
The noise seemed to be coming from somewhere quite close at hand. It was all very mysterious.
Bang, bang, bang! Bang, 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 bang!
And then it happened. Suddenly, there was a loud splintering noise. To everyone's astonishment, the conductor seemed to rise several inches into the air. Mr. Gruber, Jonathan and Judy watched the conductor's podium in alarm. First, a broom handle came into view. Then, a few seconds later, a familiar-looking hat. The hat was followed by some equally familiar-looking whiskers. "Excuse me," said Paddington, raising his hat politely. "I'm looking for a Mr. Schubert." But his voice was drowned in a wave of applause. The whole audience rose to its feet and there were cries of "Bravo!" from all around. "No wonder they call it the Surprise Symphony," said a man next to Mr. Gruber. "What will they think of next?" "Encore! Encore!" The conductor looked at the audience and then at Paddington. "Perhaps," he said, "you can suggest something as an encore. How about Schubert's unfinished symphony?" Paddington considered the matter for a moment. "I think I would much sooner have something that's been finished," he said. Then he had one of his ideas. "If you like, I'll show you how to conduct my very own tune. That is," he added hastily, "if you don't mind." "After you," said the conductor. And with that, he handed his baton to Paddington and stood back as the entire Royal Albert Hall resounded to the music of Paddington Bear. There can't be many bears who've had their own music played at a concert, said Judy later that afternoon as they drove back home. "One way and another, it's been a very musical day," said Mr. Gruber. He turned to Paddington. "Did you enjoy the concert, Mr. Brown?" "I did, Mr. Gruber," said a sleepy voice. "Thank you very much indeed for taking me." Paddington had just discovered that if he closed his eyes, he could still hear the music. And if he closed them very tightly indeed, it was just like being back in the Royal Albert Hall again. I think, he announced to the world in general as he dropped off to sleep, I might be a conductor when I grow up.
Thank you.